Alors, d'où vient la vie pour tenter de répondre à cette question?
Where does life come from? In order to try and answer the question, we need to redefine the context. The context is the Earth. The Earth is the only planet in the solar system which you can see here, on which life was found. And the Earth is also the only planet in the solar system where liquid water can be found. And water and life are closely intertwined. Life, in order to express itself, needs a certain temperature, and the Earth is well positioned at the right distance from the sun, an adequate pressure. Life needs a chemical imbalance. If everything is balanced, the organisms will die. Life needs nutrients, electron donors, electron acceptors, sources of carbon, and all of these ingredients can be found on the surface and inside planet Earth. Life, as we know it, the smallest unit, living unit, as it can be defined here, is a cell. In a cell, macromolecules are expressed through metabolism. And we talk about acid nucleic acid, deoxyribonucleic acid, and ribonucleic acid, made of elementary motifs, the bases, the nitrogen bases, A, T, G, and C for DNA, and A, U, G, and C for RNA, combined with sugars and phosphates. The second main category of molecules, known molecules, are proteins, huge complexes made of 21 amino acids, all with a different chemical personality. And when the amino acids form a sort of chain, a pearl necklace, they are extremely complex, with 10 amino acids, 3,600,000 sequences, different sequences can be made. And when these 3,600,000 sequences organize themselves in space to adopt different conformations, which are called globular, biodiversity is already at play on the molecular level. Nucleic acids are simpler because they are made of four motifs only, elementary motifs. Now, the context is also a matter of geological time. The solar system was formed 4.5 billion years ago, and atoms are produced by a star explosion, the sun, assembled to form elementary molecules, CH4, methane, H2O, water, sulfur, hydrogen, H2S, which then reacted to form elementary bricks, such as amino acids and nitrogen bases and sugars for nucleic acid. It took a billion years for these processes to happen and to give birth to the first cellular form of life. Traces were found in stromatolites 3.4 billion years ago, and the very early cellular forms then grew, became bigger. There was a fantastic event in evolution called endosymbiosis, the combination within a bigger compartment of smaller elementary compartments coming from different small cellular forms of life. And for the very first cells, more sophisticated cells to appear, it took 2 billion years. And these were the eukaryote cells. Then eukaryote cells learned to live together. They assembled in order to form multicellular organisms. We are multicellular organisms, 10 to the power of 14 cells to make a human being. And it took 1 billion years, an additional 1 billion years. You see here that life is a historical process which developed biochemical links with the environment over the 4.5 billion years of the history of living beings. The very first cellular forms appeared approximately 3.4 billion years ago. These cellular, original cellular forms can be found in stromatolites, stroma for layer, light for stone. And here we can see two pictures. The first one shows stromatolites, current stromatolites, forming in Shark Bay in Western Australia. small stones being formed, and in the bottom picture, we have fossil limestone stromatolites, 2.7 billion years ago, found in Transvaal in South Africa. These two pictures are very similar. 2.7 billion years ago, stromatolites were forming limestone formation identical to those forming today. And the limestone formations result from the activity of bacteria called cyanophytes, which live one after the other. They're very small, and when a layer has lived, it dies, it becomes sedimented at the bottom of the sea, and it drags down with it a number of detritus particles, which will become cemented thanks to calcium carbonate, and the detritus particle will be stacked up on top of each other until they come out of the surface of the water, and you see here this crusting process. Paleontologists Schopp and Allwood identified in very ancient stromatolites dating back to 3.5 billion years a number of cellular fossils, the very first original cellular forms which were identified as being the very first cyanophytes which were alive 3.5 billion years ago, which means that we have a way to perform a gradualistic analysis. We start from the recent times and we go back to ancient times. And this is exactly what Darwin did when he produced the theory of evolution in his book published in 1859, The Origin of Species. And we observe today that more than a century separates the theory of evolution from the methods we are currently using in laboratory, which are all based on his theory and led us to the tree of the living beings divided in three main domains, archaea, bacteria, and eukarya. Bacteria, archaea, bacteria, eukarya. And thanks to a top-down analysis, we compare in a phylogenetic fashion, thanks to bioinformatic tools, all macromolecules, all sequences found in all three domains, and we can come down to the smallest common denominator, also called last common ancestor, or LUCA, which stands for last universal common ancestor, which brings together all traits common to the three domains of life. And with LUCA, we hope that we will go back in time even further to come back to the very origin of life. Now, there is another approach, which is called the bottom-up approach. And thanks to this approach, we can perform prebiotic experiments in laboratories thanks to data provided by cosmogeochemistry, which I told you about at the very beginning of my presentation.